Hey, welcome everybody. This is Justin Christensen, the co-founder and president of Conversion Fanatics and the number one best-selling author of Conversion Fanatic, How to Double Your Customer Sales and Profits with A-B Testing. And as you can see, I got some special guests. So I've got AJ and Megan here from Praxis Metrics, and we're going to talk about data.
Data.
Yes. Yeah, the super sexy topic of data.
Yeah, we think so.
So yeah, absolutely. Thanks for being here. This is kind of a little bit impromptu. We're not really sure 100% what we're going to talk about, but we know that we're going to talk data. It's something near and dear to my heart. Obviously, these guys have created an entire company around data. And as marketers, it is important that we have the right KPIs. We have data pulling from hundreds of different sources now, you know, omnichannel and in multiple different sources, everything from average order value, lifetime values, and difficult things to calculate when you're just looking and living out of the world of analytics. And these guys solve that problem. So can you guys talk about a little bit about exactly what you guys do?
Sure. Yeah. Yes. You want to kick it off?
Yeah. So, I mean, on the simplest sense, what we do is we take all of these different technologies that all have disparate benefits, right? And they're all tracking different unique pieces of your customer's journey or of your business. And what we do is we extract that data from those separate technologies in an automated fashion so that it's redundant and reduces human error, right? Because most people that we work with have somebody in their company at some point touching Excel and manually entering some things. So we'll automate all of that system through a process called ETL, which is extract, transform, and load. So we extract the data from these systems, then we transform it, because it's like if I assigned all three of us to go and do a financial sheet for the last year, it'd all be in a different format. So what we do is we take all of this data and we clean it and massage it so that we can then put it into a data warehouse that's all in the same structure, same format, that's actual user friendly, that you can read and make sense out of. And then we take that, and from that whole aggregated data set, on top of that, we run the layers of the formulas and the analytics that then you can make sense out of it and do that cohort analysis, the, you know, historical trends, and really just use it as a business tool to then make better decisions. So every metric that we build out, we make sure it's actionable and that somebody is tied to the success of that metric and what success looks like.
So what kind of systems are you pulling data from?
A lot of them, like you said, hundreds. But if we're focusing on e-commerce right now, we're talking Shopify, we're talking Google Analytics, Klaviyo, MailChimp, all the biggest ESPs, Magento's, Marketo's, like Infusionsoft, HubSpot. Most people are probably in that range, then Recurly, and a lot of the other pieces of the business that attach to those main ones. But we also connect to lots of other stuff that none of the online marketers have ever heard of, too.
We do all the shipping and inventory data, the operations data, the manufacturing data, anything that the business needs in order to run, we can connect into.
So let's talk dashboards.
Yeah. Dashboards.
There's a ton of solutions out there for dashboards. Yeah. I've tried to use many of them, and they don't work typically. Mm-hmm. How do you guys tackle that?
Awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, this is the question, because what we love to fight against and what we hate to see happen is when companies get sold on, like, the pretty dashboard. So Instagram, there's a lot of beautiful dashboards and great offices showing the dashboard, and they say, oh, easily connect your data. Here, we'll run you through a demo, and they promise that you can do this.
And then they'll say, you can do it in just a couple short hours, you know, and it's super easy. Anyone can do it. Even a marketer can do it. You know?
And it's just not there. It's just not true. So there's this middle part that Megan talked about, and we can use a whiteboard layer if we want to, but it's connect the data. But there's this middle part of ETL, transforming the data, massaging it into actual useful data and data you can trust. That's the big thing. If it's not accurate, you can't trust it, why put it into a pretty dashboard? Literally, the dashboarding, the visualization part, is the last step we do, and it's actually the easiest. This middle part is where our core is. So when we first started to solve this problem, we were a marketing agency back in the day. We've been friends for a long time. We were building out these funnels, and we ended up doing the tracking and reporting for them. But we were doing it kind of like everybody else was, just kind of putting in spreadsheets and sharing that information. But we said, there's got to be a better way to do this. And we spent lots of money and lots of time researching every single tool and using them ourselves to figure out which one is going to be the best. Mm-hmm. And what we found out of, I don't know how many we actually ended up trying.
Yeah, like we literally went and bought all of these different dashboards. Yeah. So we have our little internal checklist of like, oh, this one was really good with this piece of it, but then it was missing this entire chunk. And basically there's two types of dashboards out there. There's single source dashboards, which the majority of them are, especially when they're targeted towards the marketing community. What they do is they have one visualization. So let's say it's a bar chart, and that is allowed to connect to one single source of truth and information. But in any business, there is no one single source. And so what it's saying is, I'll show you your Facebook trends. Great. I can see that in Facebook. Mm-hmm. Like there's no value add there. So their single source dashboards is one, which means it's simply a visualization tool. Mm-hmm. But like AJ was saying, it's missing that whole back end of combining multiple data sources. Then there are some that do allow for, no, you can in one visualization have Facebook and Instagram and this, but it's all under this glaring assumption that all of the data is formatted in the exact same way, which is just not true. Most people, when they think of data, they think of an Excel spreadsheet that they can read, and it says conversion date, and it says, you know, funnel name, and it says all these things, but they don't realize that there's all of these different algorithms or all of these different naming conventions that the companies have to put in. And API builders mm-hmm. are not marketers, and they're not even like business people. They're doing this to hard code something in, and they put in random stuff. And then there are little literal fields with zeros and ones, meaning yes and no. And you have to go and translate every column into something digestible and meaningful to the business. And then once it's in that format, you can use any visualization on top of it, and it will all be usable. But that whole piece of massaging and really making sense of it is where the value lies. And 90% of those dashboard companies out there, they're visualization tools. They're not business intelligence. Mm-hmm. They don't allow for ETL. And then the other type of dashboard company, so there's BI, there's the visualization, and then there's data. Like there's literal platforms built for data analysts.
IT teams. Right.
You guys don't need that. Like marketers, any business people that get into that stuff, it is too much. They have their own coding. I mean, even with BI, you have to know SQL. There's a lot of massaging and a lot of different languages that goes into making sense of this. But then when you get into the data science piece, it's a whole different thing. Not a lot of companies need that, especially in the e-commerce, until they're doing over $500 million in revenue. Right. So those are the biggest differences. But the problem is every visualization tool out there claims to do it all. And it's a great sales tactic. And then it gets everybody on, and then they churn them and burn them.
Mm-hmm. I've seen that.
Oh, yeah.
It happens. It's really so sad. But that's why we're here educating. We want to continue educating people. We have live workshops. We educate everybody in our sales process just to be true and transparent.
Because there is another way that you can do it too. Because there are those all-in-one BI tools, which is what we recommend because it's all-in-one. But there's another way that you can go about it. If you just want visualization, there are some companies that we work with that are more data mature, if you will. And they understand the value of having a data warehouse and having it all siloed already. So they'll get AWS or the Microsoft SQL or whatever it is in order to house all of their data. And somebody on their team, some technical guy, is already ETLing all of these different systems into one. But again, it's a computer science IT person and not a business owner. Yeah. And so what ends up happening is they put it all together, again, in just this unreadable format, and then nobody in the company ever sees that data. Nobody uses that data. When it's like that, you can also clean it up and then just layer any visualization on top of it, and we do see some clients do that. So you can kind of hodgepodge it together.
Yeah, so I mean, it's super important, those watching this, that you put action to your data. There's so many companies out there that don't do anything. I mean, I think Google came out with a study not too terribly long ago that 97% of websites have or collect data. Mm-hmm. You know, Google Analytics, very low barrier to entry, but less than 30% actually do something with it.
Yep.
And how can you run a business and expect to grow and see exponential growth in your marketing and making sure that your marketing is effective, especially in our omnichannel, very noisy digital marketplace and landscape, if you're not following trustworthy data. We see that all the time in optimization. If you can't trust the data enough, you can lead to false positives, go down the wrong path. You know, you could be 3 months down the road and decide, figure out something actually wasn't what you said it was going to be.
Exactly. You can't manage what you don't measure, right? And then, and there are lots of companies out there that want to say, oh, hey, these are 100, here's 100 metrics for you. Nobody can look at 100 metrics. Like, you have to have whole teams of people. What we do is say, all right, let's take those 100 and let's figure out what the needle movers are. What are those 8 to 10, maybe 20 metrics that are leading with revenue, gonna help you get that return on investment? And then our model has always been kind of lead with revenue and then land and expand. Well, let's get your marketing and sales data taken care of, right? Let's make sure you're able to do this with your
let's increase your revenue,
and decrease
your
expenses.
And later we can start decreasing expenses.
And solve all these other problems, because then inventory problems are there. Like, customer service problems are there. Cool, we can bring all those things in so that you have like what we call a command center for your business, or a cockpit.
Mm-hmm.
One place for you to make the decisions, not all over the place.
Yeah.
For investors, for the team, for whomever, if it's in one place and in one very similar format, then everybody can make the right decision.
But the problem is, and you touched on this, but I really want to, you know, spend some time on this. Most people, again, like they see these dashboards out there all over, and they do have 100 different metrics, and then it's paralysis by analysis.
Mm-hmm.
You're spending all your time looking at these charts and figuring out, well, why did that do this, or why did this do this? And then nothing gets done. And so what we like to do is, for every single metric, every single card, every visualization, who's responsible for it? And what are the actions that they're going to take if it goes up or down? And that's where that consulting piece comes in, you know, like, so if your conversion goes down, who is ultimately responsible for this? Mm-hmm. Because if 20 people are looking at it, but nobody's taking action, it doesn't matter,
mm-hmm.
right? And so it's setting up alerts, dynamic alerts that are smart, to where I get notified if I'm responsible for this metric. And each person in the organization is responsible. Their job and their annual review is based on a metric,
mm-hmm.
something that's controllable by their actions. That's where we really see, you know, let's whittle it down. And so that's a huge piece of what we do, is like that weaning down of the important metrics. And then the other thing is democratization of data. Too many organizations have one person who's the nerd, who knows it all. And then they're responsible for notifying or even just translating it to the rest of the team.
Right.
But they don't know what they don't know. And so there are some people that, when they have their eyes on a metric, they'll have different insights. And they'll have different values and different actions that they would take from it. And so what we do is we say, well, let's let everybody see it all. Because
mm-hmm.
you may make a correlation that nobody else can. And just give every person in the company the access to this. And then they can, they don't have to do everything, but they're tied to one metric and they see it all.
Mm-hmm. Like sales team seeing, putting it up on
the sales team seeing the revenue
on TVs,
data.
That's fine. And then the executive team, the C-suite or the decision maker, there's permissions where only he or she gets to see the financials,
certain
things, the overall
yeah.
stuff. But then with the rest of the team, let them see it. Let them compete on the sales level, and let them compete on the marketing level. Let them all go towards one big goal.
Yeah, and you get a fresh set of eyes
mm-hmm.
yeah.
if you're not just very linear in your focus on the data.
Right.
We see that all the time when we're doing optimization for companies. We'll come in and say, oh, you missed this, 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 and this, because they're so close and their blinders are on.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they get, you know, so close and they don't see the forest from the trees.
Right.
Oh, definitely. 100%. That happens all the time.
So going back to metrics, what are some of the key metrics that people should follow when they're looking and leading with revenue with what you guys do?
Great question.
Yeah. And it really depends on the business. I mean, we say that every business suffers from terminal uniqueness.
Mm-hmm.
Every company is 100%. They've set something up that's just unique to them. But it typically always follows a similar pattern, right?
Yes, yeah.
And if we just talk about e-commerce for now, you know, it all comes down to cost and revenue.
Mm-hmm.
So we typically start with revenue. You know, what are those key things that are driving revenue? Now, some companies, it's one-time purchases, and some it's subscriptions.
Right.
Some it's
sometimes
online
it's
sales. Sometimes it's offline sales. Sometimes it's a combination of all of the above. So we'll typically start weaning it down. So let's just talk about e-commerce sales in, you know, online subscription revenue,
sure,
for example, because subscriptions are making a huge, mm-hmm, huge play in the market right now. So we're seeing more and more subscription data. So one of the biggest metrics that we see clients ask for is, it's always easier to keep a client paying more longer than to acquire a new customer.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So how do we increase our, how do we decrease our churn and increase our lifetime values of our customers, or increase the average number of months that they are a subscription client, mm-hmm, right? And so that's a very easy, like, whittle down. Let's look at just this very simple use case. And what are some of the business questions? Our goal, so we always start with metrics mapping.
Right.
It starts with high level, what's the business goal? We want to increase revenue and increase subscriptions.
By okay, how much specifically?
Right. How much specifically?
And how much more time?
Now, yeah, what are the natural questions?
The simple method.
The simple method. Yeah, simple. Very, yeah, very
smart,
chunked
the
up.
Smart method.
Smart, yeah. Smart, yeah.
So we chunk up big business goals, and then we drill in and we say, okay, so when you see this goal, what are the natural questions that you guys have? Like, just spitballing. You're like, well, how do we get the customers to stay longer? What is making them leave, right? At what time period are they leaving? Because you can always do autoresponders. There's so many different ways you can increase those, mm-hmm, but there's natural questions that come up. So we start with the business goal, then we go into the business questions. And then for each business question, we reverse out one KPI. And that's our process. That's when we sit down with customers, whether or not they have the list of KPIs they want, that's our process to always get that list. So we, you know, there's churn, there's the monthly, there's the, what's the product breakdown? You know, mm-hmm, if there is a certain segment of my market, when they buy X, Y, and Z, they stay on for 24 months, yeah, versus 12 months, I want to know that.
You want to sell more of that product.
Exactly. What funnels earlier were they exposed to? The customers with the highest LTV. What funnels were they exposed to? What product breakdown did they buy?
What source and did then they come from?
Yeah, and then what email sequences have they been educated on in the meantime, right?
Yeah.
And those are the things that then I want to duplicate on these other channels, right? If my Facebook average subscription rate is 12 months and my Google organic is, you know, 24, I'm going to start duplicating some of those things in that channel. Make sense?
But again, you don't know what you don't know.
That's the problem.
Because some of those numbers are not easy to calculate.
Oh, no, no, no.
Lifetime value is not an easy metric.
Oh, no, no, no.
So many, everybody wants to do it a little bit differently, too. Mm-hmm. We have a kind of a structure, the way we've done it, and it's really nice to be able to see that by source as well. But this is that chicken and the egg. It's, we know the metrics that we want to put in front of e-commerce businesses, but then it's, we identify, oh, by the way, there's some holes. That's why we do these audits up front. To make sure we know a snapshot in time, here are the red flags, here are the green flags, and here's the yellow flags. We got to fix this stuff first, or else we're going to see a hole in your LTV.
So or that it's means, just going to be completely inaccurate, and you're
exactly,
making bad decisions
on
yeah, dirty data. And that's what most people run into. So they'll come to us and they'll say, I just want one metric. I just want LTV. Just laugh, you know. And then we'll walk them through, and then we break down and sit down, and it's so funny because we'll assign clients to do this and never happens because it is very complex.
Mm-hmm.
So instead we sit down and we say, we're gonna tackle this together. So here's what LTV really means, but you can customize the formula. There's like 100 different ways you can calculate LTV, and every company needs to calculate it differently based on their operating structure. So what we do is we say, let's look at this formula. And if this formula pieces together 10 different things, are you tracking this? Yes. If so, what system is the source of truth? Because a lot of people, they're tracking it in Shopify and also in GA, but the GA data is not showing accurately.
Yeah.
Okay, well then let's pull it from Shopify.
Or is the Shopify not showing it accurately?
Exactly, right? And then it comes down to these standard operating procedures. So what ends up happening, it's funny, companies come to us all the time with these, oh no, I just need this thing visualized.
No, you don't.
No. And then we end up talking to their entire organization and tracking each, like, sitting down with them in their day-to-day operations saying, so why didn't you track that? Why didn't you push that button? And they're like, oh, well, because I just needed to get onto this. And it's like, well, that's the missing linchpin. And now everything else depends on that, mm-hmm, right? And so there's always this buffer of retraining staff, retraining the mentality. Even most people, when you talk data, glaze over. Yeah,
completely.
100%. They're like,
numbers.
Hopefully
people are still listening now.
Oh, yeah.
I know, right? Even just mentioning Excel, people are like, I'm out. And they start moonwalking awkwardly away.
We got smart marketers watching this.
So okay, good. But even smart marketers, when you start getting granular, it's like they don't understand that if we get granular, it can literally double their business by just tracking one extra field or 10 extra fields and tying that to the revenue and letting them see what other companies have seen and the growth ticks that have happened because they've been tracking this stuff. That's where, I mean, it's education. And that's what it comes down to.
And that's the problem, too, that we see in the optimization world. I mean, everybody shouts from the rooftops that I just need to get more eyeballs on what it is that I have to offer. You know, I just need more traffic. That's going to fix all my problems.
Right.
No.
No.
You need to get 10 times more results out of the traffic that you're getting. Maximize that. Like you said, it takes far less time and energy and money to keep a customer than it does to acquire a new one.
Yeah. If the bucket has holes in it, it doesn't matter how much more water, you've got to plug all these holes. So once we go back and do that, it's not the fun part, it's not the sexy part, but it can be done and it just needs to be done a certain way and then repeated in the future so it becomes an SOP. But then that's when the numbers, you can actually look at the dashboard and we have people that they trust it. And then it's like, wow, I had no idea. Now we can go do X, Y, and Z, and then it's fun to just watch that grow.
But here's the little asterisk though.
Disclaimer.
Yeah, disclaimer. It's never done.
No.
It's an organism.
Ever. It is a living, breathing organism that is just as dynamic, if not more so, than the entire business because it's a reflection of it. So every split test, every new funnel, everything that changes, it all needs to be tracked. And so it's like you almost have to every month like audit, but that's the difference between the companies that are doing $100 million in revenue in just e-commerce than the companies doing $5 million and $10 million. And it's like the dot-com boom. The people in the early 90s that had their company online and retail, those are the ones that knocked it out of the park and took over the market share. Now is the dot-com boom with data. Mm-hmm. If you're not doing data, your competition is, and they're going to see the things that you don't, and they're going to take over. And people are now starting to hear these buzzwords and like, oh, I need to be tracking multi-channel attribution. And then they don't even know what it means or what action to take from it. And so, you know, it's really right now we have this awesome opportunity to educate the small to mid-sized market, because big companies and large enterprise organizations have been doing this for decades.
But not all of them. But a lot of them.
Yeah. They very true. A lot of them still have a lot of room
to
grow.
They spend millions of dollars on what, quote unquote, big data.
Right.
You know, that they're trying to get the most out of it that they can. Not that they're actioning on it, but, you know, it's definitely there. And I know the education process. It's just, it's hard.
Yeah.
And it never ends. But there is something to say that when you can trust your metrics, something magical really does happen.
It does.
I mean, we've seen so many times with different platforms, it's like you get a false positive and then you have 20, 30% discrepancies in the data versus a 3 to 5% discrepancy in the different channels. It makes a world of difference.
Yeah,
it does.
It really does. And that's the problem, is a lot of people do base a lot of their decisions on dirty data. I mean, Google Analytics is a great example, because most companies, even the ones doing a lot of money, don't realize that the Google Analytics dashboard that you're seeing is a sample data set.
Mm-hmm.
It's not hard, true numbers. So, and every single person should go and try this right now, and you've probably seen this. You'll go in, you'll run a report, and you do a, let's say, a month-long view of your conversion rates with these three different variables. And then you look at a specific date on that month, and it says you converted 100 people that day. And then when you zoom into that one day, it says 180 now.
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, oh, my data's all wrong. Oh, no. But no, it's that Google samples the data because there's limits of what they can show you, and there's a lot of data. People don't realize what is being tracked. And so Google samples those longer ranges, and then they look at this, and they're like, ah, all data is wrong, and all data is inaccurate, and I can't trust it. But they just don't understand the data that they're seeing. But Google has that little yellow thing that pops up and it says, this is sample data. It's only showing 90%. It's rounding up. And if you, you know, and there's a way, there's ways to understand it and to really make better decisions on it. But if they don't understand it, then they're making wrong decisions, or they're just throwing the baby out with the bathwater and saying, data's never right. Oh no, it is.
There's a lot of jaded people in that capacity.
Oh yeah.
Or people that just don't have analytics set up, you know.
Right.
I can't count how many times, even in the last month, I've logged into somebody's analytics and said, what do you mean you don't have demographics enabled? Or you don't have any goals whatsoever.
The guide.
You don't, there's no e-commerce tracking and you're running Shopify. It's like, why? I can't tell you anything when you're not even tracking revenue.
I don't mean to laugh, but it's
a serious problem, and that's why we're here educating. That's why we're out, and we will educate anybody who wants more information. We can definitely do that and go in more detail. But this is where we're at. This is what it takes. There's no one click does it all kind of thing. We can't do any website builders to just do it for you. It's not like that anymore. Or it's not like that yet, at least.
Yeah. Not until Watson's
not
in the way. Yeah.
So AI takes over and does all that stuff for us.
Yeah. Which we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see.
Yeah.
We're using a little bit of AI now, but that's still not there.
Oh, definitely. But it is, it's so fun. I mean, for us, because we're nerds, but it's really fun to see the SMB market changing because of big data being available. Like, even just the opportunity to warehouse data as a company doing less than $5 million in revenue, like, that's huge. That was not available, and it wasn't standard and norm for the last forever. Yeah. It's never been a thing. So we're at this cutting edge, and anybody who's looking into this or even just listening to this is already head and shoulders above 90% of the businesses out there.
Yeah.
It's incredible.
That's a good point.
It's fun.
Very good.
Yeah.
I don't know what else I want to talk about.
I mean, there's so many opportunities, and that's, we really enjoy doing this because every company that we work with, we get those ahas. You know, there are a lot of those standard KPIs that we do over and over and over again. And then there are some companies that, you know, somebody comes on and they're like, because we ask them, we're like, so what, here's what you asked for, but I'm not sure that this is what you really want. Because when you see this, what are you going to do? Or what's the next question that you ask, right? And we'll actually talk through with them. And it's really awesome to see this insight because every person that we work with is very, very unique in every company. And we'll go through and we'll show them the metric, and they'll say, well, when I look at this, I'm actually, the number one concern I have or question I have is, what does that mean? Or oh, this might be tied to this. And we're like, oh, well, would it be helpful if we also laid this in? They're like, oh, yes.
Yeah.
And it's like this really cool brainchild that we just create that's, it's all new. And so there are those standard KPIs that we do for every client, and then we always build on top of them, and it becomes something new and something awesome, and it's
useful.
And then it's those creating those drill paths. I love the drill paths because we're like, all right, so you saw that spike. What's the next question you would ask? And they're like, I'd ask this. So then we create these drill paths to where they click on it, and now it brings them into this next layer of depth and
a visualization as opposed
to
raw data.
Yeah.
Because usually you just click and there's raw data, which can be helpful for some people. But it's cool because data always tells a story, and data or numbers never lie. So we can help by, what's the business question here? Okay, answer this business question. And it just goes deeper and deeper and deeper. So if you're in a presentation or a meeting or whatever, or somebody is just sitting there analyzing themselves, it's super cool to be able to have the data in that way. And then it's useful and people are using it every single day. And you can run your command center from your phone nowadays with the technologies we work with. You can have the pulse of your business right here and alerts. You don't have to be in it. We don't want to have people looking at dashboards all day. We want to be able to set up those alerts, those thresholds that text them, that Slack them, that email them before anything's going wrong, or to celebrate the big wins, and you don't have to be in the dashboard. So that's where we can get everything to, which is really fun. And then there's our consulting that says, hey, have you thought about it this way? You know, now we've got your data. How do we really scale you?
Mm-hmm. Scale is cool, but most people don't ever get there because they don't have the right data.
Yeah, I know. And it's so sad. And that's the really interesting thing is, you know, we see clients with wonderful messages, wonderful products, and then they just get outmarketed.
Mm-hmm.
because somebody else is tracking the data.
Yeah. He or she who markets best wins.
Sure. Yeah.
And we see that too. One of our biggest messages is that with optimization, you can basically eliminate any competition because the majority of people are not doing
optimizing.
It. Yep. Yeah.
It's extremely true.
And one of our mutual friends who we were talking about earlier, he said early on, he said, I'm just going to outmarket everybody else, or I'm just going to outconvert everybody else. And he did a damn good job of it for just massive growth in his company. Just because he did. He just knew exactly, I can spend $30 more to acquire a customer and still be profitable by X, Y, and Z.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And when you know that data, and you know the unique paths and the purchase paths that and the different products that are going to lead to longer and bigger lifetime value, I mean, the growth is really exponential.
And that's a great point too, because I feel like a lot of people, you know, put a river between them and, oh, well, I'll start tracking my conversions when I get that revenue. But it's never too early. Like, if you start tracking the conversions, then you can optimize them and then it'll get you more revenue. And so it's never too early to really jump into that. And so a lot of people are like, oh, it seems so complex and I'm going to need, you know, $50,000 in 6 months of just this in order to solve this problem. Well, no, even when you're a small company, just setting up the right stuff in Google Analytics, it's a free tool, you know, and just doing it right from the get-go, you can just set it, and then as you grow, just optimize those new things, and then, you know, and so it's like anything else.
It's like building habit. Start with one metric, you know, revenue coming through, you know, just some basic metrics. That's what we do. We're here for long-term relationships. We're here not to just, in 30 days, boom, it's done. No, this takes time, and over time, everything can keep growing, but the cool thing is we can all see how it's getting better as we go. Mm-hmm. So it is like doing one thing at a time, and not taking on everything. Just laser focus on leading with revenue, and then the rest will take care of themselves. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
How many times do you guys get the question of averages? Like, by this industry, we get, what's the average order value, or what's the average conversion rate?
Oh, all the time. Yeah, like, well, the benchmarking.
Yeah.
People just wanna know if they're doing well, mm-hmm. and if that's, if they wanna know what to strive towards. But it's very difficult. Because we have a unique insight because we've done so many that we can tell them, oh, well, you know, in our experience, we've seen this and this and this and this, and here's the range, and this is what you should shoot for. But a lot of people don't have that insight, especially if they don't work with agencies. Mm-hmm. We love clients that work with agencies because the agencies are doing these things and solving these problems for 100 different clients, and they're getting the benefit of that. Mm-hmm. And so it naturally has that. They get benchmarked automatically by other people's successes.
And I always tell people there really isn't an average. There's some benchmarks, but there's really no average.
Yeah.
And people say, well, I need to be converting at 3%. Well, why? You know, if you can convert at 1% and have your average order value be higher and you have 70% more traffic.
Again.
And you keep the customer longer.
And you make more money. Your conversion rate, I tell it,
doesn't
and I
matter.
Even wrote
it
in my book, that conversion rate's a relative number.
It is.
And I speak on this all the time. Conversion rate doesn't mean anything. Mm-hmm. Yes, I'm a conversion rate optimization company, and it's in the name of my company.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're paying attention to the other metrics, mm-hmm. like average order value and cost per acquisition and different things that actually drive and move the needle rather than how, you know, I got 16% of people convert today. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes when we're optimizing, we're not optimizing for conversion. We're optimizing for revenue per visitor or engagement or micro commitments to then further down the path.
Yeah.
And so many companies fail to visualize that information and the value that necessarily provides rather than, oh, my conversion rate didn't go up today.
Yeah.
You were right on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had a company not too long ago that we took their conversion rate from 2 to 3% and then they turned on 70% more traffic in 2 weeks.
Uh-huh.
And then their conversion rate tanked.
It goes way down.
Because we had been optimizing, it only went down to 2.1.
Huh.
But they had 70% more traffic. And they're like, why is my conversion rate in the toilet? Well, it's not, because you just made a whole truckload more money.
We just had that happen. We just had that same thing happen. Or like they ended up doing all sorts of variable split tests and everything, and then they weren't tracked. And then all of a sudden, like, their conversion rate went actually the opposite. Like, went way high because now all of a sudden they were getting a quarter of the traffic, you know? Yeah. Like, and it's so funny. So it is all relative, and every company does suffer from terminal uniqueness in that way, that the benchmarking is very difficult cross industry because there are very different things. And you think they're subtle, but they're very big things that are different between every single organization. Mm-hmm. It's really interesting.
Well, yeah, you have different hard good costs. You've got different, you know, fulfillment. Yeah. You've got different customer service. You've got all these other different variables. It doesn't matter if you're selling the same exact product in the same exact niche. Mm-hmm. You're one company could get by and might need 3% conversion rate where the other one needs 1.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we see it all the time in the health and wellness. I mean, look, you mean you got companies doing $20 million that their conversion rate might be 0.75%.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah,
you know, it doesn't matter. And it's like, oh, if I could just get to 1%. And other companies, mm-hmm. I mean, we've got a client right now that's converting at almost 9%.
Mm-hmm.
And if you did that in health and wellness,
yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
billions.
Yeah, I mean, that's the same. I mean, it's
well,
all relative.
That's what comes down to Kaizen. You know, mm-hmm. it's all about those incremental.
You saw that in the hallway.
Yeah, like we, it's yeah. one of our core values.
It's our core value, and it's actually down the hall in the office.
Yeah. Which
means
I mean, it's
continuous incremental improvement over time. Just getting it a little bit better every time. Not these big spikes. They will happen, but you know.
But it's also competition with self.
Yeah.
It's mm-hmm. when you relate yourselves to somebody else, then there's always something that you're going to be swaying back and forth, and that's where you get on in these weird tangents. But if you're always just competing with yourself, and here's what we were doing, and we just want to do that better.
Yeah.
Every day, and then every person is responsible for a different piece of it, making everything better, it will all naturally increase.
It's easier to push 100 people 1% forward than one person 1,000% forward.
Yep.
So if you're moving all of these different variables and these different small micro improvements, you know, I say at 1% improvement a day, you got double the improvement in 100 days.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So people just try to swing for the fence and hit these home runs constantly. We talk to companies like that all the time. That's just like, oh, we need a miracle. You guys are awesome. So where's my miracle?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, well, it doesn't work like that. So I see that. I mean, I'm sure you guys do too, because you're more in the data than we are.
Yeah.
You're way more in the data than we
but
are.
But we need those implementers.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
We do it from a conceptual standpoint, and from the data perspective, it's, all right, so here's what your conversions are right now, and your goal is to increase it, but how specifically, right? And then that's where a lot of our clients then are like, well, now what? You know, like, how do I get that from that 1% to 2, or just to 1.5?
And that's higher.
You know, and then it's higher,
Why we send them your way, or maybe they have the people internal. A lot of, I mean, it's kind of 50-50. Some are like,
yeah, it just depends.
Great, let's go sprint. We know what we need to go do. Thank you so much. And then other
then
times, it's,
like,
okay, well, we can help consult you on what to go do. I'm a marketer. I still help on the marketing side, but,
yeah,
you know.
We're not the implementers.
It's
we're
like,
not
hey,
going
to
go in
and find somebody
business.
To do these things, but at least they have the implementation list. At least then you'll go do these things. This is where you should put your money and your time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you guys got down to all of the awesome things that you can do with the data,
mm-hmm.
but how does that actually apply to the end customer? How do you guys specifically help?
What do you mean?
Like, what is your exact service?
In the puzzle. Oh,
yeah,
okay, got
in
it.
The puzzle.
Okay.
How do
so
you guys...
we help, so we can, we call ourselves an outsourced data team. So a lot of these companies, they don't want to hire an entire full-time staff because data people are super expensive. We know. We have them all on staff. And so instead of them spending, you know, $110,000 a year on one guy whose sole job is to look at numbers, we have a whole team with different expertise, API builders, data scientists, data engineers, dashboard engineers, right? People with different skill sets who can work in 10 different platforms and understand the back end of all of their data. So what we do is we can work as an outsourced data team to where we can do it all for them. We can build out the ETLs. We can manage the data warehouse. We can build out the dashboards themselves. And we can consult on that mapping metrics process to define the KPIs up front and then the ongoing support. Or we can just also recommend the different platforms to them and consult them or do the mapping metrics completely separate and then they go build it themselves. Or we come in and we do trainings. So we'll do on-site 2 to 3 day trainings or one day where it's just a deep dive. Hey, let's shake out the rug. And then here's your implementation list, right? So it scales depending on the maturity of the organization and how much they want us to be a part of that.
Yeah.
And when it comes, like, we have education component, data services, and the platform. All three of these are needed. Usually, depending on the data maturity, there's level 1 to 4, low maturity to high maturity. It depends on where they're coming in. And that's why some people need less education or less of the metrics mapping process up front, and they just need to get on a great platform that they're going to be able to grow and scale with. They're at 2 million. They're on target for 5 to 10 million in the next couple of years. There's automatically, there's platforms that we like, do not get on these. You need this one, and let's get you on that. And then we actually help them connect their data and build out those metrics. So we are a full service data, you know, outsourced data team there, but we have all the components.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
And we try to be platform agnostic, right? So there are some clients
same
that come.
Us, yeah.
There are clients that come to us and they've got a certain tech stack or they want a certain, you know, visualization tool. And we'll always consult them and just give them our honest feedback. But it's hard to remain platform agnostic when you've worked in all of them. It really is.
It is.
So our team.
Huh? Yeah. I have my favorites.
And we have ours, and our team does, because we've used them so much and worked with them so much that we've seen the holes and those walls mm-hmm. and those limitations that the client will run into. And maybe this is good for you now, but if you're going here, you're going to have to redo all of this in 1 year, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so we are actually platform partners with a couple different dashboarding tools and visualization tools that allow us to do the BI in-house. So we'll work with companies that want Tableau and Microsoft BI or Sisense and Looker. But then we've got our ones that we always recommend because we know it inside and out and it doesn't limit us.
Yeah. We love Grow. We love Domo.
Yeah.
They're fantastic tools. But we've got the experience of people come and just say, hey, I want this one.
So we're resellers as well, because we're partner dealers with basically all of them. But we'll tailor it based on what the client actually needs, and we'll consult them to which bucket they actually fit in.
And one big thing is, like, part of our pitch, if you will, is that we're helping bring the enterprise level tools down to the SMBs. This is very, very important, because a lot of these things aren't available and are still very expensive. Mm-hmm. But we have a very unique way of being able to put people on monthlies. You know, instead of paying huge annual fees up front before you even get the work, we like to say, let's start small. Let's win. Let's have a relationship where we're going to keep getting better and better. We start with those first metrics.
Yeah, so I'm glad you mentioned that, because this all sounds very complex, which it is, but it's important. And you guys have taken that barrier to entry to big data down to these small business owners that might not, you know, maybe you're doing $1 or $2 million in revenue. These guys can still help.
Oh, for sure.
It isn't that you need to be doing $100 million to be able to do this and access that data, but it's important if you want to scale up to that 5 and 10 million that you get off on the right foot.
100%. We don't want to just say, hey, if you're not hitting 5 million, we know we have talked to you. No. There's the one main thing is called our metrics mapping process, and that is an education component. Before we talk about pretty dashboards or anything else, it's, look, this is this in this one cost, it takes 10 hours, you spend time with us either online or we go in person. And we do all the metrics mapping, get the data-driven mindset spread out through the whole team. Then we can talk about, all right, what's the next step now? So we've compartmentalized it, made it very accessible to companies. And if companies are doing under $1 million, let's say, and they just need that education component, it's super affordable. Mm-hmm. It's $2,000, $2,500 to understand for us to come teach this stuff to you and actually help you get those metrics ready. And then maybe you just need to take one or two of those and get Google Analytics done. Mm-hmm. Our team can help you, or you can go find another team to do it. It's really available now, and I think that's definitely, thank you for bringing that up. That's what's really unique about this process. It's not complicated. It is complicated, but we are making it very, very simple. We can help you with those steps.
There's actually this week we had a client who they're not even at the million mark in revenue yet, but they couldn't afford to hire a marketing consultant to help them with they didn't even know basic conversion optimization. Mm-hmm. They didn't even know what sales funnels were. And they couldn't afford to do that. And they could afford to get us, coach them on the data. And then we actually built out the dashboard for them. And we delivered it last week. And she was like, this is game changer for us. And they couldn't even afford a marketing coach, right? And we were able to get them that. And now they've got their 4 different dashboards that they're using every single day. And it's going to get them there so much faster, and then they can hire the marketing people and do all this stuff. And that was just the foundation. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely becoming way more affordable with these, you know, opportunities that we have.
Awesome. So How do people get in touch with you?
Great question. Well, we're at praxismetrics.com.
How do you spell that?
P-R-A-X-I-S. Okay. Metrics, M-E-T-R-I-C-S, Praxis Metrics. And a little bit of insight into that,
it's an Aristotelian term. So Aristotle said that there's theory, teoria, which is thinking about these things that can help humanity. But then there's praxis, which is the practical application for the betterment of humanity. And so we want the practical application of data for the betterment of humanity.
That's why we named it Praxis. It's a little hard to spell sometimes.
That's way in depth.
It's really just to give you that tongue twister.
Yeah, very simple, very simple. We know. PraxisMetrics.com, and also we're on LinkedIn, we're on Facebook.
And his email is aj@praxismetrics.com, and I'm Megan, but it's M-E-A-G-H-A-N. Miegahan.
Way complicated.
I know. So just reach out to you.
I'll link them down in the next to this video.
And so you go to the website, get on there. It's not a growth audit. It's just like a data strategy call. We'll jump on for 30 minutes, ask these questions, and can walk you through. We got lots of cool visuals, which we didn't have time to do today, but we can go deeper down the rabbit hole.
Yeah, if you guys want to find out what the heck your data is actually telling you, I highly recommend reaching out to these guys. Known them for a long time. Know they do great work. And happy to have them here sharing their knowledge with data. So until next time, we'll talk to you guys again soon. Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.